2017, and I want to invite you all to give me any of your ideas, give us any of your ideas for programs that you might want to see next year. So we'll start up again in 2018, probably with grapevine pruning in February. That's unusual. Anyway, so I just want to welcome our speaker today. It's going to be all about the flocks of winter. Lynn Mosley, Dr. Lynn Mosley, from who's one of our Master Gardener volunteers.
Yeah.
And she is going to teach us all about the snowbirds. Lynn?
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
Yay, thank you all. That's good. Well, so nice to see everybody, and thank you for coming to hear this presentation about birds of winter. And it's so timely because just as I was walking to my car to come here this morning, I heard the first yellow-bellied sapsucker. Some people think that's a made-up bird name and there really is no such thing, but trust me, it is, and we'll talk about them because it's one of our winter visitors. You're supposed to have an outline of what we're going to talk about, and then talk about it, and then tell people what we talked about. So this is a long list, most of which will take only a very short amount of time. But I will tell you what my plan is for today. First, I'm going to introduce you to the four what we call status categories of birds that spend time in our area or at really any temperate zone habitat. Why do we have those four different categories? Why aren't our birds all the same all year round? Third, if our birds change in populations over the course of the year, how do they know when it's time to arrive or leave? And where do they come from? This is a program about winter birds, birds that are here with us only during the winter. Where are they when they're not with us? And one of the reasons I think most of you are here, what are these winter bird species? How do you identify them? And if you would be so inclined, how do you attract them to your backyard or your front yard? And keep them there, yes. And there will even be a little bit of plants mentioned in that part of the program. And at the end, there is a quiz. So when we get to this part, you do have to pay attention. The first item of business then is to describe the four status categories. This is what birders call groups of birds that appear seasonally during the year. The first and probably our most common and well-recognized backyard birds are permanent residents, and that doesn't need any definition. These birds are here with us because the resources that they rely on are available all year round. Some of the examples include most of our woodpeckers. Red-bellied woodpecker and downy woodpecker are the two most common backyard woodpeckers and two of the most common birds that you'll see if you provide things like suet or sunflower seeds mixed with maybe a little, some peanuts, or peanut butter logs. Red-shouldered hawk, this is one of the birds of prey that lives in neighborhoods, residential neighborhoods, all year round. And then cardinals, chickadees, robins. Some people who might be from Pennsylvania or Massachusetts or Michigan think that robins are a sign of spring. Well, down here, they're a sign of any season of the year that you can name because they are truly permanent residents. Our resident robins are actually joined by residents from Michigan and Massachusetts and Pennsylvania, but we have robins all year round. And the last two birds are a male and female house finch. I'll be talking more about them later. The second category of birds includes some lesser known species, some of the most colorful ones, neotropical migrants. These birds can't survive our winters. They migrate to the tropics, Central South America and the Caribbean, to spend the winter, but they come back here to breed every summer. So the conditions are right for them to spend the breeding season in North America, but not right for them to spend the winter. So they go on a tropical vacation every year. These include warblers, many species of warblers. This is a yellow warbler. Indigo bunting, beautiful songbirds. Wood thrush, even more beautiful song. And of course, hummingbirds. A wading bird, the green heron, and the gorgeous scarlet tanager. The third category of birds are known as passage migrants. These are birds that breed farther north than North Carolina and winter farther south. So we have two opportunities each year to see them as they're passing through, hence the name passage migrants. In the spring of the year, April and May are the big months for these birds to be making their voyage through the southeastern states from the neotropics up to the northern U.S. and Canada where they breed. And in the winter months, it's late August through early October when they're making the reverse migration. They're going back to their winter vacation homes. And the term neotropical migrant is used by birders and ecologists to refer to this category of birds. And they're also known to be one of the groups of birds that are the most highly endangered in terms of having experienced severe population declines of 60% and more in many, many cases, because they get hit from any change or any kind of pollution event or habitat destruction in three different areas, and their breeding grounds in North America, their wintering grounds in Central and South America, and at any stopover point along the way, because they can't fly straight from Alaska to Venezuela, although some birds can. And the last category, and the one that we'll talk about today, are the winter visitors. And I'm going to, in the last part of the program, go through some specific species that you can actually see at your feeder if you provide certain minimum kinds of food that attract these species in particular. And they include ruby-crowned kinglet, yellow-rumped warbler, hermit thrush, white-throated sparrow, dark-eyed junco, and pine siskin. And I'll talk about almost all of these in at some length at the end of the talk. So, any questions about status categories? Yes. Bay-breasted warbler, Blackburnian warbler, black pole warbler, Canada warbler, Swainson's thrush, semi-palmated sandpiper.
She's not going to put that on the
test. No, that's not going to be on the test. That'd have to be extra credit, Mary. So the next question to ask is, why are there these changes? Why do those warblers have to fly south for the winter? Why can't everybody just stay with us in our backyards in North Carolina? So, let me ask you this question. Let me turn this to the audience. If you were a bird in, say, the northern part of the ruby-throated hummingbird's range, why would you find it necessary to fly thousands of miles to get to Costa Rica when you weigh about a fourth of an ounce, and I'm not kidding, a fourth of an ounce, and your voyage takes you across a 500-mile Gulf of Mexico where you can't stop to refuel? The demands of that and the energy that it takes, well, we just can't even imagine it. Computers for a long time couldn't figure out how hummingbirds could cross the Gulf of Mexico, given their metabolic rate, how much fat they can store, and so forth. So there has to be a pretty good reason for leaving. What do you think it is?
Food they need.
Food. I'm so glad you said that. Food. That's exactly right. The flowers aren't available. And all those warblers that I just showed the picture of What are they eating? They're not eating nectar from flowers like hummingbirds, but they're eating what?
Seeds.
Not seeds.
Insects.
They're insectivorous. When you see birds that have little thin beaks like these four, that's a sign that they're insectivorous, because you need a big honking cardinal beak to crush heavy fat seeds like this. This guy doesn't eat insects. See his big fat conical beak? That's a junco. He's a sparrow. What do you think this bird eats? That's a teeny tiny insects. Okay. So their food isn't available. They have no choice. And if you look at the birds that are permanent residents, they are able to find food of a type that is available 24/7, 365. Okay, so that's the reason. But the follow-up question is, what is the timing cue for the signal that gives them the drive to, okay, this morning it's time to leave, or tonight we're going to leave as soon as the sun sets, because most of our songbirds migrate at night. It can't be food, because when hummingbirds fly south for the winter, there are still plenty of flowers available in the backyard and in nature for them to feed on. But what would happen if they waited until all the flowers were gone? It's too late, and they still have a lot of land to cross where they are going to stop to refuel before they make that voyage across the Gulf of Mexico. And by the way, some of them fly down through Mexico and northern Central America in order to get to Costa Rica, so they don't have that over water journey, but many of them do. So in science, in behavior and ecology, we have two categories that I think are really important: ultimate causes of behavior and proximate causes of behavior. So food is the ultimate reason for migration. If they ran out of food, or if they couldn't find food available in January, they're going to die. So that is the one thing that causes them to go to all the trouble of finding their way over thousands of miles of trackless ocean or land that they've never even flown over. Think of a bird's first migration as a first-year bird, a nestling hatched in, say, June, and come September it has to fly to South America. It's never done that before, and oh, its parents have already left before it leaves. So it's hardwired, totally hardwired. It's genetic. So what is the cue that sends them south at the right time of year? And the answer is photoperiodism. Right. As you know, during the seasons, during the seasons, the amount of daylight changes literally from day to day, unless you live right on the equator, in which case we have 12 hours of daylight and 12 hours of darkness every day, all year long. We refer to photoperiod as the light-dark cycle, and we express it as the number of hours of daylight, the first number, followed by the numbers of hours of darkness. So this would be your light-dark cycle, your photoperiod if you lived on the equator. This would be a summertime light-dark cycle, and this would be a wintertime light-dark cycle. Today, for example, I looked it up. Sunrise was at 7:27 a.m., sunset is at 6:36, and so our light-dark cycle is 11:13. We've passed the point now where we have equal numbers of hours of light and darkness, and we're in the fall, so there are more hours of darkness now than daylight. So that is a signal that is absolutely constant from year to year. On exactly this date, every year, there will be 11 hours of daylight and 13 hours of darkness. So with that consistent timing signal then, birds can rely on photoperiod as the trigger to say, okay, it's time to go south. Any questions about that? It's an instinctive response. Think about this. If they had to learn the photoperiod signal to migrate, they'd be dead before they figured it out, because they would have missed that first migration timing signal. So this is something they're born with knowing. It's really rather remarkable. And it leads to not just the signal to know when to migrate, but it leads to, in the spring, for example, lots of physiological changes that result in singing. Birds don't sing in the winter. Carolina wrens do. They sing all the time. But most birds don't put the energy into singing that they do in the summer. They don't sing in the winter like they do in the summer. They don't defend territories in the winter like they do in the summer, except for mockingbirds. They're territorial all year round, because they're permanent residents, right? But even most permanent residents don't defend territories all year round. And all their courtship displays and defensive territories and flow of hormones that cause their physical appearance to change. Look at this example here. This is a male scarlet tanager, which is one of our summer visitors in breeding plumage. This is a male scarlet tanager when he's not breeding. This is a male American goldfinch, which is a permanent resident in breeding plumage. This is a male American goldfinch in the winter. So when you see these guys and you think, where are all the male goldfinches in January? Well, they're there. They're just being a little bit more subtle in their coloration, which makes sense. My next question was this. Okay, we're talking about winter visitors today. They're birds that breed farther north and winter in our area. They don't need to go to the tropics to find enough food to survive the year. Where do they come from? So I randomly, and really this was just kind of randomly, pulled up range maps from Breeding Bird Surveys, which is an annual survey that a lot of us do once a year during the breeding season to compile millions of data points that the Fish and Wildlife Service collects to plot where birds are during the breeding season. And what I want you to note here is that blue is where birds spend the winter, so North Carolina's right here, and this kind of dark orange is where birds breed. So for each of these species, look how consistent the breeding range is. There's some, like the yellow-rumped warbler, that breeds down in the Rockies and the West, but most of them are breeding in maybe the very northern parts of the U.S., but most of them are up in Canada. And so that's where they are, and where they are specifically is, this is a U.S. Department of Agriculture map of biomes of North America. Biomes are large areas that have a particular type of habitat. And the biome of interest is this one in gray. Notice how that area coincides with the breeding range. This is the northern boreal forest. Forest boreal. Boreal means northern. And it is this forest that is characterized by a dominant community of conifers, as opposed to deciduous forests like we have down here. Spruces, firs, hemlocks, pines, yes, but a lot of spruces, firs, hemlocks, larches, tamaracks, things that are needle-bearing, cone-bearing, and are evergreen. That's where these birds are spending the breeding season. And it is a huge, huge habitat. There are more trees. If you look at the transcontinental biome that goes through northern Europe and all across Russia, there are more trees in that biome worldwide than in tropical rainforests. So it has hundreds of thousands, millions of square miles of habitat. But it looks like this in the winter. And they cannot find the insects they need. Many of them are insectivores to survive the winter. So down they come to spend the winter with us. So here's the part where you need to start paying attention, looking at the pictures. I'm going to go through a list of birds that are fairly easy to attract to your backyard if you have any kind of a feeder set up at all. And even if you don't have actual feeders, you can attract some of these by throwing certain kinds of seeds on the ground, as long as they're the right kinds of seeds. So we'll talk about that. White-throated sparrows. White-throated sparrows started arriving last week. They are birds that breed in the northern coniferous forest, and they're ground feeding birds, which like to hang out in flocks. So usually you won't have one white-throated sparrow, you'll have a small flock, maybe half a dozen or a dozen. And you can see why they're called white-throated sparrows. They have this white throat right under their chin, and it also has this little black line that separates the end of the white throat from the rather plain breast. The belly is white. The upper chest part here is a little shaded, grayish. But they also have another, well, really two other really clear field marks. They have a striped crown. And you see this patch of feathers here? Those are called lores, L-O-R-E-S. It's a term that's used to distinguish feathers that are between the beak and the eye. And for some reason, a number of species of birds have a distinct coloration on their lores. So, yellow lores, white throat, little black line demarking the end of the throat, plain belly. Now, one confusing thing that might lead you to think, are there two species of sparrows out feeding on the ground or just one? One of the sparrows, like the one I showed in the first picture, one of the color phases has a black and white crown. The other has a brown and tan crown. And there's no difference in sex or age that causes this. Again, they're just born that way. It's like some people have red hair, some people have brown hair. There's black and white morphs, and there's brown and tan morphs. You might find this interesting. Studies have shown that a male black and white morph sparrow won't breed with a female black and white morph sparrow because they're both too aggressive to get along. Right. Here's a close-up of the black and tan morph, which just means form, on the left, and the brown and tan on the left and the black and white on the right. Let's say you'd like to attract some of these sparrows from Canada to your backyard. They're ground feeders, as I said. I rarely see them perching on a tube feeder. So to attract sparrows, you need to provide seeds like white millet, that's the little tiny round seeds here, black oil sunflower, and cracked corn. That's a blend that you can get through bird stores. And you just want to avoid some of the filler type seeds, such as red Milo. If you see a blend with little red seeds in it, don't buy that because birds don't eat it. And just scatter this on the ground, and the sparrows will be very happy. White millet and black oil sunflower are particularly handy. Now, another sparrow, although it's not called a sparrow, is the dark-eyed junco. This is what people in our area sometimes literally call snowbird. You've heard that? Yeah? because they don't arrive as early as the white-throated sparrows. White-throated sparrows are here now in small numbers. The big influx will probably wait another couple of weeks. These guys don't show up for a while. And it seems like when it snows and you've got, let's say you throw out the day's dried bread or breadcrumbs or, you know, some bird food on the snow, there they are, because they are also ground feeders. And they're pretty birds. They don't have a lot of color, but just their pattern is attractive. The real nice adult males have this slate, really dark slate head. It's almost like you took one and dipped it in the dark color just down to about where the breast ends and the belly begins. The back is a lighter gray. And then the female tends to have a similar pattern, but the color is browner. And look at the pink bill. It's not bright pink, but it is pinkish. So the pink bill, the dark hood, white belly, and something that is surprisingly noticeable as they fly away from you, white outer tail feathers. And it was hard to get a good picture that showed this. And by the way, I should say that most of my photographs are taken from the Cornell Laboratory of Ornithology's website, which is excellent. The name of it is allaboutbirds.org. allaboutbirds.org. You can search for any species of bird by common name, and it will pull up a page, really several pages, with information, with photographs of different ages and sexes and plumage patterns, and really lots of solid information. So the white outer tail feathers. And to attract them, you do the same thing you would do for white-throated sparrows. And frequently, they will feed in flocks together with the white-throats. Here's the yellow-bellied sapsucker. I love this woodpecker. Its call sounds sort of like a sick cat. I won't begin to imitate it. But the thing about this woodpecker is that it's our only migratory woodpecker. That is, all other woodpeckers that you would see in North Carolina are permanent resident status. This one is one of those northern breeders. And it arrives now and will be with us until March or early April. It has some very definitive field marks. The red cap, and the cap is red really over the entire crown, not just a patch like a downy woodpecker on the back of the head. It has another thing that even if you can't see the cap because the woodpecker's high in the trunk of a tree way over your head, you should be able to see this vertical mark in the wing. And no other woodpecker has that straight line vertical mark like the sapsucker. And then it has that yellow belly. You can see that, right? Not so much. If it did have a yellow belly, and it does, it has, you know, three or four yellow feathers. But where is the belly? Plastered flat up against the trunk of the tree so that you can't see it anyway. Anyway, I guess the ornithologist who named it had one in the hand after stuffing it for the collection and said, oh, yellow belly. But notice one thing. You see how this individual has a red throat? This one does not, and that's the sex difference in plumage in the two birds. The female has the red cap, so that is a species field mark, species-wide field mark, but the red throat is found only in the males. And it's interesting that for our woodpeckers, every one of our woodpeckers has red somewhere on the body in the males. Some of the females, like red-bellied woodpeckers, have red, but not as much. Or pileated woodpeckers, the females have red, but not as much. So red is a really important species identification mark and sex identification mark for woodpeckers. And it's true around the world, too. Yes?
How big is this?
It's not a big woodpecker. It's between, say, a downy and a red-bellied in size. It's bigger than a downy. Now, you may have come across sapsucker holes. Rhett Davis has written about sapsucker holes in his column before. They're the only woodpeckers that make horizontal rows of holes in trees, and not every tree is to their liking. What they're doing is drilling just far enough into the tree not to get wood-boring insects, which is what all other woodpeckers are doing when they bore holes in trees, but to get to the cambium layer where the phloem is flowing, so that they'll come back an hour later and suck the sap, hence the name. These are called sap wells. I wonder whether this branch really was growing horizontally, or maybe it was growing vertically like the photograph shows, but it was just too narrow for the birds to make a long row of holes, so they went up and down. It's kind of interesting. Usually they make them horizontally because they want to tap into different tubes of phloem rather than the same tube right on top of itself. One neat thing about having sapsuckers as winter visitors and hummingbirds as summer residents is this. Once in a while, the hummingbirds, since they're geared to arrive according to photoperiod and not according to weather, I didn't mention that, but notice how birds aren't paying any attention, at least in the big picture, to what the weather is when they decide to migrate. Maybe one spring, we have a late spring, the hummingbirds are arriving because the photo period is right, and the flowers just hadn't bloomed yet. That's bad news for the hummingbirds because they've had that long migratory journey and they arrive here and oops, no food. But sapsuckers are still here when the hummingbirds arrive, and the hummingbirds visit the wells of sapsuckers because not only is there nutrient-rich, sugary solution, which is sap, but the sap attracts insects. And hummingbirds actually eat quite a lot of insects. They're not strict nectar feeders. They have to have protein, which nectar doesn't provide at all. So they need those insects and they need the sugar. It's perfect. Nice little arrangement. Unfortunately, you can't attract sapsuckers to your feeders because they don't eat suet. That's not what they do. Any other questions about the sparrows or the sapsuckers?
So how do you attract them?
Well, you could plant maple trees and I think cherries and what?
Apple
trees, yes.
My granddad had a big pecan tree,
right? And there's, if you look online about damage from sapsucker drilling, you will find that there are there's advice about what you can do to keep your tree from being destroyed. Well, that happens, I don't know, once in maybe 5,000 trees or less that a sapsucker might drill into. It can damage a branch. It can weaken a branch to the extent that it would fall off, but even that is rare. And if it does happen to one of your favorite trees, you wrap it in burlap or you put a little, you know, cage of chicken wire around it or something. But what the smart people say to do is to just kind of designate one tree as, okay, sapsuckers can have that tree, and let them have it, and they'll often leave the others alone. If the sap flows really well in one tree, they'll use that tree a lot. Now, two confusing species that come to your feeder in the winter. One in the winter, really, one is here all year round. But in my experience, people confuse house finches and purple finches as much as any two birds that are commonly seen at feeders. So I thought I'd take a little time to distinguish these two species. These are close relatives. One, the purple finch, is a consummate winter visitor. That is, it breeds in the spruce fir forests of the north. It comes here in the south. It's a seed eater, and therefore it will come to seed feeders. The house finch is an invasive species in our area. It is from California and the West Coast. They were imported to New York City as part of the pet trade back in the 1940s. They were marketed as so-called Hollywood finches. Yeah, I'm going to buy a Hollywood finch and it'll be in a cage in my house and it'll sing beautifully. Well, they do sing. It's sort of a chatter. It's not all that musical. And they only sing during the summer. So people got discouraged. They let them go into the wild. And pretty soon they began spreading in all directions out from New York City, to the extent they're found all over the eastern part of North America now. There's a little area in the Great Plains region where they haven't met up with their western counterparts yet, but they will. And from Christmas bird count data, Audubon Christmas bird count data, we know that the presence of house finches year-round as a new species has really displaced purple finches. And from Christmas bird count data, back prior to 1975, we reported zero house finches in Piedmont, North Carolina. I've looked this up in the records of the Christmas bird count. Starting in the late half of the 70s, house finches began showing up. And oh, by the way, purple finches were here for the Greensboro count, for example. There'd be hundreds of purple finches reported by surveyors on the Christmas bird count. And now those numbers have totally flipped. Totally flipped. So there are very few purple finches reported in the winter on Christmas counts and hundreds of house finches. We still get them at our feeders. They are highly attracted to sunflower seeds, black oil sunflower seeds. So let's learn how to tell them apart. And these pictures are going to make it look easier than it is. Wait till the quiz. Let's see how my time is doing. Oh, we're good. A purple finch, Roger Torrey Peterson, the author of the famous Peterson Field Guides to Birds, described a male purple finch as looking like it was dipped in raspberry juice. Whereas a house finch male on the right is more orangey red. Some people say rosy red. I usually get a little bit of orange mixed in there, and I don't get any orange at all with a purple finch. A house finch is said to have a flatter head than a purple finch, which doesn't show up on this picture. Let's see some of these others. See how this guy, this is a purple finch, has kind of a peaked head, a little bit of a peak on its head. That's a good picture. Sort of, not so much, a little bit. Its head is rounded or peaked. Now look at the, oh, that's the female. Well, let me see if I, no, I didn't put that up. You'll see one later. The house finch has a reddish rump. It has red on the face above the eye and below the eye, but not right on the crown. The crown is actually brown, but it's not a solid brown cap. Another thing that seems to me to be distinctive is that a house finch has sort of spots. They're subtle spots, but spots down here on the flanks. Now, these are all males that I've shown you so far. To me, it's almost easier to tell female finches apart than it is males. The top two birds are female house finches. Note that they have fine streaks. Their entire breast is streaked. And they have a very plain face. They don't have a real broad eye line or cheek or mustache mark. The purple finches have a broad brown stripe going down from the eye toward the neck, and above that, what we call a white superciliary. That just means a white stripe above the eye, and a little bit of white below that brown. Here again, a brown patch from the eye to the neck, a white stripe superciliary above and below that brown patch. And their streaks on the belly and breast are thicker. So this is a purple finch here, house finch here. You would think these were sparrows, wouldn't you? They're not at all related to sparrows. They're in a completely different family. These are winter visitors. These are permanent residents now. But if you have a feeder with seeds in the winter, you need to look really carefully to see maybe there's something different even from the house and the purple finches. Does anyone in the class recognize these birds? Yes, Mary, pine siskins. Pine siskins. They're closely related to goldfinches, but they're here only in the winter and only sporadically. Let's get a closer up view. A pine siskin, think stripy goldfinch with a little yellow. That's your cue. They have streaks that kind of reminds you of a female house finch, but look in the wings. You see that yellow there and on the tail? This varies a lot from bird to bird. And here's a photograph from the Cornell site. Look how much yellow that individual has. But then here's a bird on a stone near our little goldfish pond, and there's no yellow visible. But look how notched the tail is. Just a big divot taken out of its tail. You can see that here as well. If you have a finch and it doesn't have a well-notched tail, it's not a pine siskin. Birders refer to a group of birds called winter finches. These are birds that go where the seeds, the pine cone seeds, or the larch seeds, or the spruce and fir seeds, are abundant that particular winter. And every winter, it's in a different place in North America. So some years, we may have a lot of pine siskins at our feeders. Some years, zero. But we get kind of excited when we do get them, because it means, oh, maybe there's some other rare birds that will show up for the winter that we only see maybe once every 10 years or so. Pine siskins. Oh, and don't you like the scientific name? Spinus pinus? Isn't that just so cute?
Excuse me, don't they always like come into birds?
They, yes, they're also very much flocking birds. And that's true for a lot of the so-called winter finches. To attract finches, it's really simple. Black oil sunflower seeds. You notice I don't promote the big striped sunflower seeds very much. It's not that they're bad. Cardinals love them. Grosbeaks love them when they come through in the winter migration or spring migration. But there are a lot of birds that can't open striped sunflower seeds because the hulls are too thick for the strength of their jaws and beak. Everybody can eat black oil sunflower seeds who's a seed eater, pretty much. And one great benefit to our winter bird visitors is that black oil sunflower seeds have the highest fat content of any seeds. And we're used to thinking that fat content is a bad thing, but for birds, it's the opposite. If you're going to spend the night with nothing but a coat of feathers out in the woods, and the temperature is 15 degrees, you want all the fat you can get. And you know, I'm a bird bander, and one thing we do when we have a bird in the hand and take data from it for its condition, how healthy it is, we can blow the belly feathers apart, and you can, the skin of a bird is so thin, you can see right through it and see a little patch of fat that's deposited under the skin. A chickadee in your backyard in January will be full of fat in the lower abdomen and right between the collarbone before it goes to bed at night. goes to bed at night, wakes up in the morning, same chickadee. Oh, there's no fat. It's metabolized it all to stay warm overnight.
Wow.
One night and it's gone. I'll remember that. For the smaller birds, the finches in particular, and siskins, they do like the Niger seed, the thistle seed. And that requires a special feeder with smaller holes, or it'll just pour right out. So a thistle seed feeder and thistle seed is good for goldfinches, pine siskins during the winter. Another winter visitor that is so fun to get to your feeder, but it takes a little more effort because it takes some different food, is a yellow-rumped warbler. Now, I just talked a few minutes ago about the warblers, which were summer residents, neotropical migrants, warblers, insectivorous, going south for the winter because there are not enough insects around here. This is an exception. This is about our only migratory winter visiting warbler. And the reason they can survive here is that they feed on high fat berries from cedars, from wax myrtles. They love wax myrtle berries. And they're beautiful birds. This is a male and a female here. In breeding plumage, and this picture here is a breeding plumage bird, they're decorated with yellow at the top, the sides, and at the rear because they have, not showing here, they have a yellow rump patch. But when it comes to your feeder in January, it's going to look more like this or this. Those yellow patches are much subdued in winter plumage. And I'm going to show you a couple of species in addition that share similar feeding preferences, and all of them can be attracted in the same way, which is how I'll finish. A ruby crown kinglet. This is our second smallest songbird. Its cousin, the golden crown kinglet, is actually the smallest. They're here only during the winter. Look at that teeny tiny bill. What does it eat? Insects, teeny tiny insects. They are so cute. They're about this big. And the ruby crown kinglet is rightfully named, except it can hide that patch. That patch stands out, makes it stand out, makes it more visible to predators. So unless it has a reason to show off its patch, if it's fussing at another ruby crown kinglet, for example, it will cover that up with the gray feathers on the head. So how do you know this bird? Well, they all have a partial eye ring, and this is surprisingly visible as long as you have binoculars or it's at your feeder right outside the window. You can see this easily. It really does stand out. It's almost like two crescents, one on each side of the eye. It has wing bars, one long wing bar here. The wing bar is that horizontal stripe across the wing, and one shorter wing bar, so two white wing bars. And you can, as long as you get a good view, you can see some yellowish or olive green color in the wings and the tails. So these are the primary and secondary feathers. And even the back looks kind of olive green. But it has a plain belly, and a teeny tiny bill. And they just look cute and chubby, unless they're agitated and they're raising their little teeny tiny red patch.
When do they come?
So they would come a little bit later, maybe in November, you could see them, through May, early May. And that's an interesting point. We call these winter visitors, but listen to this. A lot of our winter visitors arrive in October to November. So let's say late October through late November, December, January, February, March, April, May. They may be with us 7 of the 12 months of the year, which means they're spending more time with us than they are farther north.
Can I ask a question? Can we add Ruby Crown to this, or was there a reason that you wouldn't see it in your backyard?
You do add it to your list. I get them every year. Their cousin, the Golden Crown Kinglet, is another beautiful, teeny tiny, the smallest songbird in North America. And I have not had luck attracting this one to my feeders, but some people have, but they're harder to get. And look at the crown on this one. Orange or yellow orange with black borders. Several photographs of Golden Crowns. This is probably what he'll look like in the winter. White superciliary, that's that white line above the eye, and a teeny tiny eye line which goes straight through the eye. Those are the field marks for the Golden Crown Kinglet. Now, this is how you would attract kinglets, hermit thrushes, I didn't mention those, they're a winter thrush, and butterbuts. Oh, that's the name for yellow-rumped warblers that birders give them because they have a yellow rump patch. It's like a pat of butter on their butt, butter butt. Suet is very helpful, and I always recommend no-melt suet. We do have warm days in January and February, and these literally don't melt. You don't need to worry about a big, messy, melted fat deposit underneath your suet feeder. You can get simple cages like this. They cost, I think, a couple of dollars at Lowe's. Or you can get ones that have a little paddle at the bottom, and that braces the tail of the woodpeckers as they feed on it. Just a little comfort added design. These are at Wild Bird Unlimited stores. But also, consider adding a peanut butter log. My husband makes these by taking a log and drilling a 1-inch hole on, really a big enough log on four sides, and stuffing it with peanut butter. This is not his design, but what he does is add a perch underneath it, because birds like the kinglets and the warblers, yellow-rumped warblers, perch and feed on the peanut butter. But if you do a peanut butter log, be sure to add something as a binder so it's not so gluey and mushy. Get the cheapest peanut butter you can find. Food Lion has a tub that's about this big, lasts forever. And actually doesn't last that long because we go through it pretty quickly. Cornmeal and sunflower seed chips will help bind the peanut butter so it'll stick in those holes. It won't run down the log. And the birds benefit from the cornmeal and the sunflower seed chips too. Well, they like peanut butter, but for some reason, our squirrels go to the sunflower seed feeder much more than the peanut butter feeder. I just hardly ever, and they're on the same, they're hung from the same pole arrangement. And finally, to attract these insectivorous birds, freeze-dried mealworms are great. It takes a while for birds to discover that you have them. And for instance, at the end of the summer, our birds just quit eating mealworms. I think they were getting fresh insects naturally. But now that the cold weather's coming, we'll put the mealworms back out. They've been out, but kind of unused. And you can put them on a tray feeder. You can put them on a special sunflower seed, or mealworm feeder. And this is one of my favorite pictures, thanks to Mary Dingledine's husband, who's an excellent photographer. Steve Dingledine took these pictures of three bluebird fledglings that we actually banded at Mary and Steve's house. I went out with my bird banding, and if you look carefully, you can see the aluminum bands. These are official U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service issued bands. So we can follow these, and they've been coming to their feeders as a little threesome. It's the cutest thing. As best we can tell, at this point, two males and a female. And you're still seeing them, Mary?
A little bit.
Uh-huh. Not quite as much. Okay. Right. But
how do you band them? How do you catch them?
Well, these were just in the nest. They were nestlings, hadn't fledged yet.
Babies.
So, yeah, we banded them as babies. And finally, To attract winter birds, there's nothing better than having plants around your yard that produce berries that are ripe during the winter. And just I could have listed dozens, but I picked out four or five. Hollies and cedars, these are native trees that have berries during the winter that birds very much depend on. Yellow-rumped warblers love the cedar berries. Cedar waxwings, they're permanent residents, but they love them too. Holly berries, very nutritious. This is one of my favorites, winterberry. They're a deciduous holly. They lose their leaves, but oh my gosh, do they ever have berries. That's what it looks like in the summer. And spicebush, these are native plants that grow in shaded, kind of moist areas. I have a lot of them in our woods. We're on Little Alamance Creek, and we have just dozens and dozens. And the thing about spicebush is, and you can buy these at nurseries that sell native plants, they have the highest fat content of any berry-bearing shrub or tree in our area. And they're ripe in the fall as the birds are moving south. And they turn this beautiful lemon yellow color in the fall. The understory of our woods is just yellow. And American beautyberry, also a native, and the purple berries are loved by any fruit-eating species. And that's on your handout. Now, for the quiz. This is called, when I do this for my class, it's called Name That Bird. So that's, you don't need to name that bird. All right, on the back of your sheet, or on the front, either one, there are two species of birds on this feeder at the same time. And you may look at your list on the front, which is number one, which is number two. All right, there's only one more slide after this, and we're done. 3, 4, 5, and 6. This is hard. I know this is hard. This is the hardest one. This is what they really look like, though, at your feeder. Instead of those, you know, professional photographer posed in some sort of a tent where they've got the bird on a beautiful, attractive perch. This is what they look like when they're in your backyard. I mean, these were taken at my house. Well, I didn't take that one, I confess. And last two, number 7 and 8. In case you need to see that again.
Yes.
So we're about out of time. We got a little late start, but are there any questions before we get the right answers? Okay. Shall we have group participation, or would you like to raise
Please.
Your hand? Okay, group participation. Bird number one on the left. House finch. Correct. And how did you know?
Flathead.
This is a great view. And look how the head is just continuous with the top line of the beak. That's called the culmen of the beak. And look at the top. It has a little brownish patch up here. All right. Number two, then, is a? Right. Very good. Number three, I need species and sex.
Female.
Female, right. Species? Yes, purple finch. It's got thick stripes. It has that brown, big, large stripe from the eye to the neck. It has a white superciliary and white below. Number four. Number four. No, not number four. Yes. Pine siskin. Good, Carol. It's got a sharp beak. It's related to a goldfinch. It has yellow in the primary feathers and a little in the tail. It looks like a sparrow, but it's not a sparrow. It's a finch.
I was looking for the detail.
Oh. Yeah, sometimes they don't have yellow on the tail anyway. But this, more in the wing, those primary and secondary feathers, edged with yellow. All right, number five.
Female.
That's correct. She has a plain face. She doesn't have all this going on. And you can't tell that she has a flat head because she's alert. She's focused on something. She's a little agitated. And number six? See that right there? I wish you could see a better picture of the rump patch. It really looks like a little square pat of butter on the butt. Yellow rumped warbler, correct. Good. This one, ruby crowned kinglet, ruby crowned and golden crowned kinglet. Right, right. And which one is more likely to come to your feeder? The ruby crowned, right. Who got them all right? There you go. Yellow rump. Thanks. Well done, you. Are there any questions about anything? I have provided a handout over there. Some of you have received this before, but go ahead and take another if you like. I have plenty. Native plants for birds in our area recommended by Audubon, North Carolina, specifically for our area.